Good evening, folks. I'm Larson Halleck, certified personal trainer and semi-certified anthropologist. And today we're talking about a much, much more lighthearted topic than we usually discuss, and it somehow encompasses both of my interests. Today we will not be talking about how my beloved field of anthropology is kicking the modern world in the dick. Instead, we're going to talk about something literally everybody on the planet loves: food. And in talking about food, we'll also discuss how culinary debates are kicking the world in the dick. Whoops. Anyway, a matter of intense debate in really the entirety of postmodernist society is which diet is the correct diet. Some say that a predominantly carnivorous diet, or an omnivorous diet, or a vegetarian or vegan diet. Which one is it? Not making things any more simple is that such a thing often takes on a, shall we say, political veneer. Effeminate soy eaters mocking thuggish right-wing meat eaters and all that. As luck would have it, this question can be answered from a strictly biological basis. Obviously, I'm not going to deal with those who have a religious or moral issue that behooves them to eat one diet or another. And the results are, yeah, humans have in fact evolved to eat meat. Regardless of whether or not one believes the hypothesis that hormones affect your politics, and thus diet affects politics via hormones, and I don't necessarily, the fact is that not only have humans evolved to eat meat, it has direct and powerful nutritional benefits for us. First of all, let's observe the human gastrointestinal tract. It's just a straight run down from the mouth to the stomach, and things get more complicated in the intestines. Know what other kind of animal has that? That's right, an obligate carnivore. Also omnivores, the main difference of course being the teeth. In contrast, the herbivore's digestive tract is much bulkier due to the need for rumination, more processing to digest cellulose, and the like. An even better comparison is to compare the chimp's GI tract to the gorilla's. The chimp, an omnivorous sort, has the similar straight and simple tract to a wolf or a human. The gorilla has a much more complex digestive system to process its almost entirely herbivorous diet, to the point where the species itself is known for its big belly. It's not fat, it's just a sheer mass of organs. Indeed, animal products are not only delicious, but also nutritious. They have many nutrients that humans definitively need for proper function, like the B-complex vitamins, as well as other vitamins if you enjoy eating organ meats, and I do, taurine, and saturated fat. Yes, fat is indeed a vital nutritional component of the human diet, as it is essentially what the brain and spinal cord are made out of. And those are a little important. Indeed, many anthropologists feel that a major reason why humanity evolved such powerful brains is due to our hominid ancestors eating fatty animal products, such as suet, or visceral fat, brain tissue itself, and most importantly, bone marrow. Marrow is one of the most nutrient-dense foods you can eat, and the abundance of cracked long bones in anthropological sites speaks for itself. Indeed, some theorize that the big choppers and hand axes we see in Pleistocene stone tool assemblies were predominantly designed for marrow bone cracking. And let's not forget that saturated fat is especially important for us men, as it is of vital necessity for the production of androgens and other masculinizing hormones. Some detractors might be saying, that's all just conjecture, you can't prove that. While nobody can truly prove the hand axe thing, what we can prove is not only that the body needs and eagerly responds to all those nutrients and animal products, but in case studies comparing predominantly carnivorous omnivorous people to predominantly herbivorous people, meat eaters tend to win the day. Observe this famous bit from Tacitus's Germania, in which he describes their food as simple: wild fruit, fresh game, and dairy, and then goes on to describe their superiority of strength and ferocity of aspect. And yes, while Tacitus's book has been called an early predecessor to the noble savage patronizing claptrap, including by myself, that doesn't change the fact that he's saying that the Alemanni are, in his direct words, swole as fuck, compared to the average Roman legionnaire who ate a diet that was predominantly cereal-based supplemented with animal products. Similar statements exist from Chinese historians when describing their Mongol or Hunnic foes. And to go into the realms of biological anthropology, when the omnivorous Homo habilis, our direct ancestor who was clearly an omnivore due to his generalized dentition and frequent stone tool use, lived in the same range as, say, Paranthropus boisei, most likely an herbivore due to his thickly enameled teeth, heavy sagittal crest, and carbon isotope research suggesting a preponderance of carbon-4 fixating plants in its diet, who do you think survived the harshness of nature? Here's a hint. We're not called Paranthropus sapiens, are we? Even if you don't give a damn about any of those historical and paleontological examples I gave, which is kind of odd that you would be watching an anthropology show, just ask yourself how many vegan professional athletes there are. I'm going to be here waiting for an answer. Now, of course, I'm not saying that you should eat entirely a diet of meat. That has its own problems. I'm a man who also enjoys vegetables, and being able to defecate at will is remarkably pleasant as well. I am, however, saying that animal products should be a substantial part of your diet, along with vegetables and fruits and cereals and all that, if you want optimal health. So with all that being said, why the demonization of meat? Part of it is the fact that, yeah, farming vegetables does require less water use and it's overall more efficient than meat eating. I mean, that much is true. Also, as many animal rights people point out, the treatment of animals in factory farm settings is absolutely repugnant. And again, that's not something I'm going to deny. However, note the enormous preponderance of soy in the modern diet, and then note the decreased sperm and fertility counts in Western man, and the decreased testosterone as well. Could it be, perhaps, that meat is discouraged because the powers that be want a population of weak, effeminate slaves rather than strong and masculine resistors? Probably not. I'm a big fan of Hanlon's razor, which is to say that you should never attribute to malice what you can instead attribute to stupidity. Also, Occam's razor. The simplest explanation is usually correct. Thus, I don't think that there's an international conspiracy to take your man juice away, so much as it is just cheap and lazy agricultural and food businesses making a glut of soybeans and forcing them onto the market. Another reason you might be seeing this push is, seeing as the world's population isn't going to slow down, because population control is apparently bad now because it's going to happen to black people, therefore, if everybody wants to get fed halfway adequately, us evil first world people might have to cut down on our meat consumption. So that's it, we're all just going to be stuck eating soy protein, yes? Maybe not. Yes, kids, bug eating. Insectophagy. Consider it. No, don't leave yet. This has been seriously suggested as a way to maximize protein yields for all of humanity in the future. And biologically, it does make sense. Insects are, pound for pound, the most protein-dense animal product on the planet, with almost double the nutrient efficiency of beef. Many people who live their lives nailed to their spinal cords, in the parlance of Robert Howard, can vouch for this, ranging from the Mopane worm in parts of South Africa, to a wide variety of insects in Asia, to the U.S. Army's Field Survival Manual, which advocates not only which insects to eat, but how to eat them for the squeamish. Indeed, studies of coprolithes, which is to say big piles of shit, from pre-modern humans shows insectophagy was quite common around the world. So much so that the L'Etoile Ferrer cave in France has a grasshopper painted alongside more commonly thought of animals, which suggests that it was not only eaten, but desired to be eaten, to the point where they were possibly willing to include the grasshopper in a bout of sympathetic food magic. And if our ancestors could eat bugs, why can't you? To save the planet. Don't be surprised if they start pushing this sometime down the line. And frankly, compared to most for-your-own-good leftist twattery, this is actually something I would be willing to do. Now, whether or not you consider sitting around eating insects to be yet another nail in the coffin of Western civilization, that's your opinion. I'm Larson Halleck, and I appreciate humanity in all of its splendor.